Let's talk right now about population, because that's obviously the hot topic right now, and one of the reasons why there was a closure for retention. So what has the population of white sturgeon been doing here in the Columbia Basin over the last few decades?
So the population was hit pretty hard back in the late 1800s, fished down pretty substantially to the point where a lot of fisheries were closed for a long time. Over the early part of the 20th century, those populations were able to restore and build back up. And by the mid-century, we had pretty robust populations.
Sure.
As the 80s approached, and really we started seeing a lot of increasing fishing effort on sturgeon, we started doing more research on sturgeon, and all that kind of went together. We were down in the mid to late 80s to a point of about 40,000 legal-sized fish at one point, which is far lower than where we're at now.
Yeah.
And then that population rebounded after some management actions were taken, and we had some good recruitment years where we had a lot of spawning, and things were good, up to about 200,000 fish mark, not too much after that dip. Mm-hmm. And then we slowly declined a little bit to a point in the mid-90s and late 90s and even the early 2000s, where we were somewhere in 120 to 150,000 legal fish mark almost every year. It varied a little bit, but it was pretty stable. And then right about 2008, we started seeing declines in these population numbers. And so we gradually sort of lost numbers every year, to the point where in 2013, we were down to 100,000 fish or less.
Sure.
And so that's a pretty dramatic decline, and we had seen it go steadily down over time. Coupled with that, we also had some increasing pressures. You know, we had a pretty robust fishery still going on, but we also had predation, which was a pretty new factor for us starting in about the mid-2000s. About 2005, 2006, we started seeing that become fairly significant. That's a threat we didn't have back in the 80s when we reached that low number before.
Sure.
And so that's a concern, and something that we have to be accounting for in managing these populations, make sure we're sustainable.
Now, and when you mention predation, you're talking sea lions or sports and commercials too?
Well, I'd count them as two separate things. I'd talk the harvest side, which is our overall harvest, which is, you know, typically been quota-based for a long time now, going on 20 years.
Sure.
So we manage to those quotas. We do a pretty good job of hitting or staying under those quotas, but you got to have the right population numbers when you set them. So, you know, we've talked a little bit about improvements in the way we assess populations. Those will help us down the road for those. But that's a known. We can count that, and we know how many fish were taken out through the quotas.
Sure.
Predation's a different deal. We're still trying to get a handle on how many fish might be taken in any given year by pinnipeds, by sea lions. We got a pretty good handle on numbers up at Bonneville Dam because there's a good observation program there. But we also know there's predation occurring all throughout the rest of the river. And other than some anecdotal stuff and some observations we've tried to do, it's a pretty tough area to survey and get a good number on. So it's a concern.
Well, and what's interesting too with sturgeon is that it's not like counting trout in a lake. And these aren't salmon, they don't return to the exact spawning bed where they were first bred. So it's a very difficult species to really fully understand and even count. We talked about the spaghetti string tags and the pit tags, but really these fish, with their range being from San Francisco Bay up to the Fraser, they can sometimes just leave. And the population as a whole might still be strong, but our populations here in this area in the Columbia Basin need to be protected, just because populations go down. So there's a lot more to it than just simply, hey, there's this many fish, we can go out there and go harvest.
Right.
And that's, like you mentioned earlier, that's a really tough thing to do, just because these fish take a long time to grow. They take a long time before they reach sexual maturity at 25 years. And that just makes things very difficult to keep track of when you're trying to track these fish.
Right, absolutely. A fish that spawns today, we won't see their offspring at a fishable size where they'd really show up in surveys till another 10 years after that.
Yeah.
And then if you save that fish and get it to adult size, that's another 15 years after that point, and then another 25 back around the generation. So it's a long haul process. You gotta treat it as a process.
So that brings us to the most, I don't want to say important topic, but the topic on top of everybody's mind right now: why was it closed this year as of January 1st? We had a shortened season down here in the estuary. It still does have some openings up above Bonneville Dam, up in the pool, up above Willamette Falls. There's still a couple areas where you can keep them, but why was the decision made to close it here in the lower Columbia River.
Right. So the for the simplest high-level answer as to why it's closed here and not other places, which is one part of it, it's because this is one population. The lower Willamette, lower Columbia is considered one population group. We actually consider that population group to be the one that contributes to the coastal estuaries too. So actually those have been closed this year as well, Tillamook, all those places as well. Now as to the reason for the closure overall, we talked a little bit about the population declines, numbers are down, we've got increasing threats like predation, and some unknowns about what that predation is in terms of how much is going on, so it's hard to assess the risk. State of Oregon did a conservation planning process here a few years ago, kind of right in the middle of the decline process, where we went through and did a bunch of updating on all of our assessment methods and tried to get a management plan together to help us guide us into the future on sustainability. The discussions for closures really started coming up in late 2012, which is sort of in the middle of these declines we had been seeing.
Right.
And the two commissions from Oregon and Washington, during some group meetings they were having, started discussing concerns about the population status of sturgeon in the lower river.
Sure.
And recognizing things like the long life of the fish and how sensitive they can be in terms of making sure that you're looking for the long term. And they broached the subject of a closure at that point based on if we were to see another population number go down again, that they were interested in looking at a complete closure. At that time, they actually specified that they wanted that closure to take effect in 2013, January 1st. January 1st came around, and there was a move to start closing it. There was a lot of public testimony, a lot of public interaction, and the commission decided really to kind of step into it instead of a complete closure right then. And so what they did is they set a very conservative quota, dropped the bag limits and things like that, and let it go for another year. But at that point, they made a promise that they were going to close it in 14. And so that's where we are today in terms of how we got there. It all boils down really to the population estimates and the concern over the risk of these new things like predation and whether we can handle it or not.
Well, and we're out here in the Columbia River estuary today, and fishing's phenomenal. I mean, you could come out here and catch 50 good size 3 to 6 footers in a day, easy. And so the question that constantly gets asked in the angling community is, well, there's obviously a lot of fish here. Why aren't we able to keep them? But I think there's a larger overall question, and we've discussed that several times. What really is the population? What really is the predation? And so we need to be careful with it because it's a fish that takes a long time to reproduce and rebound from a population dip. So going forward, what can we as anglers do to help support the department and help in the population studies? And what are your thoughts about the potential for a reopen in the coming years?
Right, so good questions. I think starting with the last question first, I think really the question for me is when would be appropriate to reopen, not if. I think we're gonna reach a point where the population's gonna rebound. Even the year 2013's population estimate was starting to come back up over the prior year, just not back to where it had been. So even in that 1 year, we saw some short-term rebound. And I think, obviously having no retention and no harvest taking any fish out of the population this year, that's going to help some. Again, we've talked about the long-term nature. It's not going to be an immediate turnaround based solely on shutting harvest down.
Sure.
But we've got some recruitment still coming, which is recruitment of fish, small fish growing into what we call that legal slot. And we know that, is there. So we're going to be monitoring again. We're still doing set line surveys and stock assessments. We'll have a number sometime the end of this year to find out what 2014's number was. We made some projections last year, and we thought at that point it's probably going to be more than it was in 13.
Right.
There's been some numbers thrown around on that, but they're projections, so we kind of got to wait for the number to come in. And, so I think we're going to wait and see when the commissions took the action to close. They didn't give us the agencies a specific target of what they were looking for as sort of a criteria for considering reopening it. But it's pretty clear their intent was to have some good indications of rebuilding. And so, that probably means more than just one bump.
Right.
It needs to be convincing that it's on the right path. And I think that's prudent.
And we can't expect it to be open next year because, like you mentioned, one year of uptick is not substantial enough to show an actual rebound in the population. And so it might take a little bit of time here for it to happen, but I think anglers should be hopeful for a potential for a reopen for retention. However, this is still a phenomenal catch and release fishery. And if you look at a lot of other catch and release fisheries around the state, around the world, when you go catch and release, your size and quality fish tends to increase as well. And there are several fisheries for sturgeon, namely the Fraser River, even though they may not have the strongest population of fish up there, they are known worldwide for being a sturgeon fishery. And it's all catch and release. It's catch and release only. There's no retention. So there's no reason why this can't be built upon for a great commercial aspect for not only guides, but for the city of Astoria, Ilwaco, Chinook, and have a lot of people coming in from around the world to catch a 25 to 200 pound white sturgeon, take a bunch of pictures and let it go.
Right.
I mean, we had tons of opportunities today to do that.
Yeah, it was a blast.
It's great fun. And so, yeah, it's disappointing because it's a great tasting fish. Yeah, we want to keep them. We've been used to it for the last three, 4 decades. So it's going to take some time for us to adjust our mindset and be okay and comfortable with putting these fish back, catch and release, because we are stewards of this fish population. So we need to be mindful of that. We can't just always have this catch and kill mentality. And it's going to take a few years, but like you mentioned, it's a matter of when, not if.
Right.
And it'll come back around. And if the sturgeon population gets to a point where it makes sense for us to be able to retain them again, we'll be right there and willing and ready to go do it.
Yep.
Well, I can't thank you enough for coming out here. This is incredible information for us to have. It's a lot of questions that we all had, and this is a big concern for our fishing community, and we needed to have these questions answered so we could better understand instead of just having hearsay and rumors going around. So it's great to hear it straight from the horse's mouth, so to speak, and better understand this fish species as a whole.
Yeah, I appreciate the opportunity. It's been a blast, and I really appreciate the chance to come out and talk to you about these things. We, Department of Fish and Wildlife, and all of us folks who just love sturgeon because they're cool,
yeah,
we all feel the same way. We want to make sure these fish are around for all our children and grandchildren.
Well, they're incredible fighting fish. They're powerful. They're a lot of fun. They are great eating, and with proper management and support from the angling community, and support from the department, support from the commercials, and management of the predators that have become an issue in the last decade, decade and a half, we'll have a strong fishery for years to come.
Absolutely.
Chris,
I
thank
agree.
You very much.
Appreciate thank you, Cody.
It.
Appreciate
you
it.
All right, I want to catch another one here. You were getting a bite right behind
yeah,
me.
Yeah, I...